To live today is to live in many different times at once, to experience the tremendous violence of a resolved past and be swept along by the wild potentialities of innumerable wandering futures. A strange peace took hold of the present, indistinguishable from the ordinary time of everyday life, asphyxiating the world with increasingly unbreathable substances. Philosophers have interpreted the world, but the point today is to be able to perceive its atmosphere. Home, which is supposed to protect us, causes us anxiety. The uncanny is no longer what is outside. It does not come from remote territories. The uncanny is the fact of being at home and not feeling at ease.
For me, the key to this uneasiness that was mentioned, uneasiness of being at home, is a certain subtle difference between two modes of the future. In French, it works perfectly, the distinction between futur et avenir. In Italian, probably also futuro, avvenire. In English, it doesn't work, but it's a beautiful distinction because future means whatever will be, even if it's the same. Like if Trump were to win elections, it's the present and future president. But avvenir is to come. It's the next one. It's a change. So the problem is what is awaiting us just a future, the same things going on, or is there something new to come? For this, to know this, we, I think, have to abandon any great plans about the future. Because I think if there is a lesson from the history of philosophy and from our historical experience in general, is that all great plans for different future necessarily turn into their opposite. Just think about October Revolution, great emancipatory movement, it ended up in Stalinism. So I don't have this Marxist optimism. We know what we have to do to come. No. For me, the basic lesson, since I'm a Hegelian, is we, by definition, never know what we are doing. Even the best plans go wrong. And the key to approaching this deadlock correctly, for me, is to analyze the present. For me, most productive for the future, for the possible future, is just a close analysis of our predicament today. And I will give an example here of the usefulness of Hegelian category of concrete universality. To put it very simply, abstract universality is what many species, examples of some universal notion, have in common. Like there are men, women, transgender people, or different races, whatever. But you abstract certain features and you claim we are all human. But I think this is not how it works in a historical situation. Concrete universality means that in every historical situation, a certain particular phenomenon hegemonizes the all, is representative of the all. Marx, in his Grundrisse, explained this very easily, where he says that in pre-modern societies, agriculture was the basic field of production. You have artisans, you have other people doing other things, but everything was structured or overdetermined around by agriculture. In modern industrial society, it's industry. Even agriculture is industrialized. And now, maybe something new is emerging. That's what we have to ask. Is it digital elaboration of data or whatever? What is the particular species of production which colors it all? Now, what has this to do with our problems? I think that a nice example of how the category of concrete universality works is it's today's movement of Black Lives Matter. You know, centrists or right-wing liberals don't like the phrase Black Lives Matter. They claim that why should only Black Lives Matter? Why not all lives matter? But I think that's the paradox, that the only way to be truly universal today is to say Black Lives Matter. Why? Because not everywhere, but at least in the United States, the police brutality against the Black is representative of, is the most exposed form of racism in general, of the violence of power and so on and so on. So you cannot talk about all lives matter. You cannot be against violence of the state apparatus without focusing on the Black. And the paradox is that if you say no, all lives matter, you silently, although you don't say it, privilege the predominant white ideology. The standard by which you measure all lives is already modeled upon middle-class white people. For example, the Trump partisans who broke into Capitol building, they definitely follow the all lives matter notion. It's the same, for example, in Germany in 1930s. It would be absurd to analyze racism in Germany without mentioning anti-Semitism. Anti-Semitism was the type, the concrete universality, the specific type which determined the entire field of racism. And things change here. For example, today, I claim, in Israel, the predominant type of racism is what the state of Israel is doing to the West Bank Palestinians. So again, you cannot fight racism there without confronting the problem of how Israel is dealing with the West Bank Palestinians. So you see my point. You can be universal only by focusing on a concrete case which is representative of this universality. For example, that's why Marx analyzed English capitalism. It was a single capitalism which stood for the universality of capitalism. It was capitalism par excellence, capitalism cat ex ochen, and so on and so on. So again, when we hear today all kinds of universal phrases, you know, like human rights in general, everybody should be protected, and so on and so on, look for the concrete case which gives color to this universality. This is, for me, the great lesson of Hegel today. And of course, the same goes for other domains. I agree that to talk about sexuality, sexual freedoms, and so on, you have to confront the problem of transgender, LGBT, and so on and so on. There is always one concrete knot, which is the key to it. The problem with abstract universality, if you say everybody should be free and so on, it's not that it's too universal, but again, secretly, it's not universal. We know this from history, how when they started to talk about universal human rights, 17th and 18th century, it is ridiculously clear that their notion of human rights was modeled upon relatively affluent white men and so on. So women were already put on second place and so on. So although the formula was universal, again, a certain species, white privileged men, educated and so on, was clearly the model for all. That's why even with political revolutions. French Revolution, yes, but it became a world phenomenon only when it was joined by Haiti Revolution, when blacks joined it. It was crucial for redefinition of human rights to add these all other examples. And that's again the problem today. Even when we talk about something so common and global like the ongoing pandemic, the pandemic, maybe we should, as some of my friends from Latin America propose, deglobalize it, not in the sense we each fight it on its own. But let's just focus on how a certain model, mostly West European, maybe American, of the pandemic serves as a global model. We speak about first wave, second wave, are we now approaching or not third wave? But this is West European rhythm. In Latin America, they had a different rhythm and so on. You know, this doesn't mean that we should analyze them differently, focus just on Europe, just on America. It means that the true globalism is not some general features, but the very difference between how the pandemic goes on in different parts of the world. This is, of course, conditioned by global capitalism, interchange today, and so on, and so on. So again, my message is concrete universality in the sense of every universality has, in this sense, a concrete character. And now I come back to the starting point, to future. The true change must be the change of this frame itself. In a true change, the unwritten, people are not aware of it, implicit content of universality changes. Like the change in the notion of human rights is when white men are no longer secretly the model of human rights. For example, when women enter, when other races enter. So again, the true change is implicit, not in the sense that things go better measured by our usual standard of human rights, but it's the change in the very measure by means of which we measure reality. Standards have to change. That's the true historical change. With feminism, for example, the change, the first act of feminism is not make, in whatever way it's appropriate, women's life better. No, the first act is that women, one tends to forget this, women had to set new standards so that they experience their situation as unjust. As some feminists recently remarked in a very appropriate way, are we aware that till, I would say, the late 19th century, I would say, most of sexual acts, copulations, were measured by today's standard rapes, non-consensual sex. And the great progress is that we established this new standard that women no longer accept as the horizon of their happiness, family life, or whatever, you know, that they perceive what was once considered their normal way of life as something unjust. So again, as a philosopher, I'm telling you, don't just change things which appear unjust. Change the very standard by means of which you measure what is just or unjust. This is the true revolution.